Hi friends, we are going for Yojana May month 2021 Federal Structure part 2. So we already finished off part 1 and we are taking two issues in part 2. So those issues are the title One Nation, One Election and Challenges in Federalism and the Way Forward. So these are the two topics we are going to see today, and we also see some previous year questions based on this topic. Hi friends, we go for the article One Nation, One Election. So first we need to understand the importance of this title, One Nation, One Election. So we know that India is geographically spread, very large, and also India is a diverse country. So that requires to make a political system, and also constitutionally, we have the concept of federation, where we have union government and state government. Union government for entire India and state government for respective geographical spread. Based on language in India, we created state governments. That's not the only criteria. So on this context only, that comes the idea called one nation, one election. So what is this one nation? Treating entire geographical unit as entire India as a one geographical unit consisting of union government and state government combined. That is one nation. And what is this one election is? As a citizen of India, you are asked to vote in different elections in India. So what are the different elections? If you want to put in layman terms, one we say about MP election, another is MLA election, and also local self-government. So these are the three elections where, as a citizen, we directly participate. So in this concept of one nation, one election, here they are referring about conducting an election simultaneously for both MP level and MLA level. That is called one nation, one election. I think you are able to get an idea. If you want to put in very simple terms, one nation and one election. Here when you say one election means they are speaking more about direct election. So indirect election, good example is Rajya Sabha MPs and President is a good example of indirect elections. In this direct elections, there are three. In layman terms, MP, MLA and local self-government. And this one election is speaking about this one, MP and MLA elections. So all this two combined is called as one nation, one election. So you just have a basic understanding of this term. So we go for the article. That is page number 29, paragraph 1. So in this paragraph 1, they speak about the constitutional aspect. So, constitution regarding this one nation, one election, that is regarding Article 83. So, Article 83, subclass 2. The House of the People, unless sooner dissolved, shall continue for 5 years from the date appointed for its first meeting. So, it's saying about the tenure. That is, any Lok Sabha lifespan is 5 years. And why this becomes important is, especially regarding One India, One Elections, we need to synchronize, combine union government and state government terms. So that's the reason they're referring is Article 83. Similarly, when you go for next page, I put as paragraph 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there is a reference of Article 174, which also speaks for state government. So what the bottom line of this articles is, any legislative body, especially Lok Sabha or legislative assembly, is being formed in India, the lifespan is only 5 years. Or if you want to call it in other sense, if any government is formed, if you are a prime minister or chief minister, your tenure is 5 years as per constitution. So in the concept of one nation, one election, so there should be a synchronization. So these need to be combined. Then only you can conduct a simultaneous elections in India for both Lok Sabha and MLA level. So that's the point they're saying about. So ultimately they're asking, saying is there should be a constitutional amendment. Constitutional amendment for Article 85 and 174. So Article 85 is for union government, 174 state government. You need to amend it
regarding this tenure so that you can synchronize both union government and state government for conducting elections. So why this synchronization is required is, though constitution says that there is 5 years for Lok Sabha or state legislative assembly, there are chances where they can't complete this 5 years. So what may be the reasons for that? One aspect is, so at the mid of third term, or sorry, at the mid of third year or fourth year, if government lose the confidence, what happens? That need to be dissolved, correct? Similarly, if a state is being implemented with the president rule because of any constitutional failure. So all these are the different possibilities which acts as a challenge for this one nation, one election. To set right all these things, this amendment need to be done. So that's the thing what they highlighted here. And also another most important thing they are saying, why we need to, what are the things along with the amendment need to be done is, so whenever in assembly or whenever in legislature, that is given in paragraph 3. So whenever in legislature, no confidence motion. So no confidence motion is being passed in legislature. The advice is given us, or the recommendation what they say in this article is, once this no confidence motion is being passed, you know what the outcome is. The government need to resign. And the governor, or it can be president, think about the other possibility to form the government. If that is not happening, automatically house is dissolved. That's what the constitution says. But this article gives a recommendation saying that whichever party comes with this no confidence motion, mostly it will be initiated by opposition parties. The name itself says no confidence. Mostly it will be done by opposition parties. Once they are coming out with this no confidence motion, this particular paragraph says that that particular party also need to have the confidence to form the government. So they say that along with this no confidence motion, they need to come along with confidence motion. That's what they say, vote of confidence. So this is a suggestion so given regarding this one nation, one election, so that there will be a commonality in conducting elections. So assume that in a state government, a party is losing majority and they are going out of government. And when an opposition party is initiating this no confidence motion, that party, opposition party also need to come out with the ability to form the government. So ultimately, you can have this one India, one election, or one nation, one election. So that's the suggestion given. So these are things regarding constitutionally what need to be done. And next, in paragraph 4, why we need to have simultaneous elections. Actually, the article is designed in such a way that they start with historical background, why it all started, how it all started, one nation, one election, and historical examples are given. So 1950s until 60s, we have this practice. Then, right now, what are the things need to be changed? Then the author comes out with the reason why we need to have this one nation, one election. So there are two major reasons given. One is to reduce labor, time, and expenditure. So this is one reason. And second one is regarding governance. So one nation, one election improves governance. We'll see all how it all happens. First and foremost thing, when you take elections, who are the stakeholders? That we need to clearly understand. So stakeholders are the players involved in this particular process. So we know that stakeholders, first and foremost thing is political parties. The next thing is Election Commission of India, a stakeholder. And third, people. So these are the major stakeholder in election process. Why I'm listing out this is, why we need to have one India, one election, or one nation, one election, you can understand from the stakeholders' perspective. So what are the benefits for political parties? What are the benefits for people and Election Commission of India? If you take this first point, reduce labor, time, and expenditure. And you can relate that with political parties and Election Commission of India. Ultimately, you can understand the importance of this particular initiative. So that is in paragraph 4. So there are two major reasons. One is to improve the governance. We'll see that. And also to reduce the labor, time and expenditure for stakeholders. And they have given some points based on that. If you take paragraph 5, so especially regarding election commission, there is no duplication of electoral rolls and there is no need of extra labor expenditure involved in this count. So when you take this election commission of India, what are the benefit is no duplication, no extra labor. So electoral rolls, no duplication of electoral rolls and no extra labor or expenditure. So what are the benefit for election commission of India is if they are conducting simultaneous election for MP level, MLA level, they can prepare one electoral roll. So what is the concept of electoral roll? For example, in a constituency, who are the people going to take part in voting? So they have give the list of voters, all this part of electoral roll. So they can prepare once which can be used both for MP and MLA level. And there is no wastage of resources in that because there'll be you create one booth where you are conducting election simultaneous for MP and MLA level. So these are the benefits for Election Commission of India that's given in paragraph 5. And paragraph 6, what are other advantages? Again, that is related to Election Commission. So especially deployment of central police forces. So you know that for elections, Election Commission is responsible to have free and fair elections. So when you say free and fair elections, especially for this free and fair, especially fair elections, so there should be a requirement of law and order maintenance. So there comes the role of central police forces. And when you have simultaneous elections, deployment of central police forces will be very easy for Election Commission of India. It all you relate with this reducing labor, time and expenditure, why we need to have one nation, one election. So you can easily understand that deployment of central police. These are all benefits for Election Commission of India. And also saving of transportation. These are very microscopic. So saving transportation. So Election Commission is able to save transportation. Apart from transportation, they are also able to save training, remuneration. It's because one payment of remuneration or money for one time and you're conducting election simultaneously. So these are the benefits for Election Commission of India. There are 4 or 5 points which you can relate with why we need to have one nation, one election. First point, correct? And also there is a question being asked because of one negative aspect or one of the challenges for Election Commission of India is when you're getting a simultaneous election, when you're going for simultaneous elections, that may be an expenditure incurred in EVM machines. Because when you go for electronic voting machines, you're conducting two elections, MP and MLA level. For that, you need to increase the numbers. So that is one argument they say. And that is what being highlighted here in page number 30. And again in page number 31, I just list out P1. P6, P7, P8. So they have given some factual informations. For example, in P1, paragraph 1. So what are the cost involved in it? So there will be for EVM purchases. So EVM purchases of extra 4,000 crore need to be there for simultaneous elections. But they say that this is not extra burden on the Election Commission of India, especially in financial terms, because you are able to save in other areas. So expenditures of Election Commission in other areas being reduced, for example, transportation or training or remuneration. So all this administrative cost is being minimized, which can be used for purchasing this EVM machines, which cost around 4,000 crore extra for simultaneous elections. And what are the benefit for parties that is given in paragraph 2? So election expenditures for parties. Election expenditures for parties. So this article speaks about the legal limit of election expenditures. Okay. And we know that based on state, the legal limits varies in India. For developed states, it will be around 70 lakhs. For MP elections, that's the maximum limit where you can explain. But practically, it runs into crores and crores of money. But when you write an answer, you are speaking more about legal version of it. So the point says this says is where the political parties were able to save the election expenditures. So this is regarding parties. So we are going for the second stakeholder, that is political parties, what are the benefit for them. So that is one. And also how they are able to reduce the cost is because advertisement cost, election campaigning and all these things are reduced because in one go you are going to convince the people for both MP level and MLA level. MLA level elections. So that's the benefit here, what they say about paragraph 2 and paragraph 3. Next we go for second point regarding this governance, improving in governance. So one of the biggest challenge right now in India because of election related to governance is the term called model code of conduct. So that is given in paragraph 4. So model code of conduct. So name itself you can understand. So model code of conduct, especially implemented during election times in India, and it's a self model code of conduct for political parties. There is no legal backing of it, so all the political parties accept it. And this model code of conduct creates level playing field for all political parties. So why this is most important is especially ruling party has a greatest advantage during elections because they have a lot of resources at their command. So it can be government resources which can be used for the election campaign. To avoid that, they created this concept of model code of conduct. So because of this model code of conduct, how it impacts governance is, right now it's a rule says that whenever elections are being announced, government cannot make any major decisions. So that's a requirement. So take an example of union level, every 5 years elections come. But when you take union governments and this model code of conduct impact in governance, you can see that because state governments comes into picture. So major decisions cannot be taken because of this election process happening at the state governments, though it applies for the state level. So you can ultimately see that governance is not enhanced because of this short duration of this model code of conduct. To set right that only, so they have given this concept of one nation, one election. Okay. So they have given all this, what is the reason for this model code of conduct. Okay, so they have given the background of it. Okay, next thing is local body elections, that is paragraph 6 and 7. So regarding paragraph 6 and 7, local government elections, which cannot be coupled with one nation, one election, there are reasons for it. So what are the reasons? One aspect is as it's a local elections where you can see that state election commission comes into picture. So that is one reason. We have two authorities, correct? Central election commission of India and state election commissions. So these are two different entities involved in election process when you take local self-government and conducting simultaneous election for all the three at one go, that is MP level, MLA level and local self-government. It's very tedious process because two institutions are involved in it. So that is the reason we can't do it. That's one point they are saying. Now, apart from this, the polling stations, one is authorities are different. So authority is different in this particular election, that is state election commission. And apart from this, polling stations. So polling stations for local elections is very different when compared with MP and MLA level. So polling stations are very microscopic in local self-government elections. Too little to say that even that can happen in each villages. Okay. Whereas you can see that in MP or MLA level, that's not the situation. So polling stations are very different. And apart from this, jurisdiction is also very different. What is jurisdiction is? So if there is any issue regarding elections of MP and MLA level, the jurisdiction goes for High Court. So you can take the issues for the High Court. Whereas here it's a district court is involved. So, but the implementation authorities are the same personals. If you go for one nation, one elections, including local self-government, so that is very tedious process for them. And different authorities are involved. Administrative wise, it is Election Commission of India and State Election Commission on that aspect. And another thing is jurisdictional wise, High Court and district court is involved. So it will create a lot of confusions and coordination problems will be there. So that is the reason why we should not have this one nation, one election, including local self-governments. That's the reason they have given, so why it's not possible. Then lastly, for people, that is paragraph 8. So what are the advantage for people in one nation, one election is? So they have given this election fatigue. So election fatigue factor. Because of frequent elections, people also lose interest in election process, because most of the people right now after 1991 got migrated and settled in different places, and frequently going to their particular constituency and going for voting. That is one reason. Apart from this, people also not like going for elections very frequently. So that may be the reasons why election fatigue sets in. So to avoid that, if you have one nation, one election, people also getting benefited. This is the key term, election fatigue factor, which can be avoided. Okay. So you'll see a question on this to understand how we can fit this point into that particular question. Okay. So for this topic, we'll take a previous year question of UPSC, and right now the question will be displayed to you. So what are the key focus of the question is, when we have a simultaneous elections, where it is able to save time and money in electionary, and the next part of the question is it reduced government accountability to the people discuss. So that's a question. So there are two aspects of the question. So one, it says that it's able to save a lot of time and energy, time and money, and another part is on the critical dimension they're asking whether its government accountability is being compromised. Reducing government accountability discuss. So you need to say all the different dimensions of this topic. And as the first part of the question, so you need to say why simultaneous of election is required. So that is a initial part of the answers. And next, you need to focus on how it is able to save time and money in electionary. Here you can take the stakeholder perspective. So you can say for election commission, how that is being done. So saving time and money. And you also need to focus on political parties, how time and money is being saved. So that may be the focus of the answer. So in this, you can also discuss about the EVM cost, because it's a discuss question. You can say what are the different perspective of this. Even though the money is being saved, there are issues where there are areas where election commission also need to spend extra money. So that's the first part of the answer you need to address. And this points what we discuss right now is ample points to write the answers, because we are seeing from election commission of India perspective and political parties perspective in the aspect of how to save time and money, correct? But a second part is, if they say that whether government accountability to the people will be reduced. Here you can take a stand stating that that's not the true aspect. When you go for simultaneous election, it's not that government accountability is being reduced. The reason is, when you go for simultaneous elections, it doesn't mean that people are going to vote for a party for both MP and MLA level. That's the argument right now kept by some people in India, especially from the political angle. But the reality is not that, because a lot of research says that in India, people vote based on understanding the issues very clearly. So what is national level issues, state level issues, based on that, they're going for voting. So accountability is ensured in that aspect. So it's not that accountability against the government is being reduced by one nation, one election. And apart from this, can also add a point that election is not the only accountability mechanism for the people. So election is one of them. What are other accountability mechanism? Either it can be social audit or it can be RTA. So based on that, government is accountable to the people on day-to-day basis. So election is accountability only for 5 years, or 5 years once. So you can write an answer based on this ideas. Okay. So that two aspects of this question, just touch upon that two aspects. And the first aspect of the question regarding how it reduces time and money, this part of Yojana, what we discussed, you can literally write all the points there. That will be more than sufficient. And second point regarding government accountability to the people, we doesn't need to accept the argument saying that even our government accountability is not compromised here, because people are very conscious in making their decisions, especially decision about their candidates whom to win. So that may be the answer for this question. Okay. So we go for the next article. So next article is challenges in federalism and way forward. So we already saw that federalism includes three major types. When we say federalism means, so you need to divide into three layers. One is administrative level. So federalism happening at administrative level, legislative level, and financial. So these are the three levels of federalism, and they are saying about the challenges. So how these challenges are happening in these areas. So challenges, and who are the stakeholders in federalism? Stakeholders means who are the parties involved in it. One is union government, comma state government, relationship between union government and state government, and state government, comma state government. So these are the stakeholders involved. Just give a outline of federalism and challenges in these areas. Okay, so in this we go for page number 42, paragraph 1. So in India we say federalism. Okay, so in India we say federalism, but so India is not a true federalism. So there's even a term called centralized federalism. Centralized federalism. It's a federalism with centralized character. So why this required? They have given the historical perspective in paragraph 1. So the founding fathers, especially our Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, so very much interested to have a strong center. The reason for that thing is diversified India. So India is a Indian diversity is very high. So what is the outcome of that diversity? We are an young democracy, just came out of colonialism. So there may be a tendency to move out of India. So we can see that historically also, when British left India, there are two administrative units in India. One is British India and princely states. And there are around 500 princely states, and which was being consolidated and war fought for it. And you know the historical perspective. So all this resulted in influencing a constitution towards strong center, or what we call as centralized federalism. This is the historical reason why in an Indian constitution we have this strong center. So that is given in paragraph 1. And next we go for page number 43. So paragraph 1, 2, and 3. So in paragraph 1, so Indian federalism is called as by K.C. Vere as quasi-federal. So quasi-federal means half-federal, right? So which with unitary feature, which more focus on unitary feature. So there's an constitutional expert giving comment on Indian constitution, saying that though we say a federation, India is not a true federation. We have a strong central tendency. For this he gave the term called quasi federal. So this point you can use it in your answer writing, any question regarding federalism, especially Indian federalism based question or anything based on that. You can use the quotation of this particular thinker, and you can quote it in your answers as an introduction to make the examiner clearly understand that what's our Indian federalism background. So what we are focusing on, to clearly state that Indian federation is not a true federation like US. Okay, so that you can relate with paragraph 1. And paragraph 2, so right now our Indian federation, one important constitutional office is related to federal concept, that is regarding constitution. So we have this Finance Commission. So Finance Commission is an important constitutional office directly related to federalism, especially fiscal federalism. So which recommends revenue distribution between center and state. And we know that center have the majority control over the financial resources, especially based on Finance Commission recommendation. But the paragraph says that this being altered after GST introduction. So Finance Commission determines resource sharing. So determines here means determine the principles on which the resource need to be shared between union government and state government, and most of the financial resources controlled by union government. And recently we have GST, which altered this relation. So this point you can clearly state that what are the challenges for federalism in modern day era. So challenge for federalism, one point is regarding the reforms happening in tax structures like GST, which has a huge impact on physical federalism. So that can be a challenge here. So that's the title says, challenges of Indian federalism and way forward. So GST is one particular challenges for Indian fiscal federalism, because right from our Indian constitution, we have finance commission to share the resources. Right now GST is there, and we, when you say GST means, you also need to relate with GST council, which determines the rate of taxes and all. So all this has a huge impact. Where right now you know that most of the taxes of indirect nature comes to the union government, sharing need to be done. So all are being altered. So this GST can be a challenge for federalism. So that you can write as a point in your questions. Anything asked about Indian federalism and its challenges. So that is given in paragraph 2. And paragraph 3, so they say about administrative relations between union government and state government. And they have given an example where health belongs to state subject. Health belongs to state subject. And here you know that the major player in health is state, but coordination role is done by, so coordination role is done by center. So constitutionally health belongs to state subject, but health has a huge impact on the entire Indian system, where union government is playing the role of coordinator. So how we can relate this challenges is right now in the pandemic situations. So you can see that that is the biggest challenges for federalism, because the prime mover of health is always state, and where coordination need to be done by union government level. So this is one good example how when the environment of India changes, where challenges exist for federalism, especially from administrative angle. This is one good example where they have given health as an example for it. So that is in page number 43. And next we go for page number 44. So paragraph 1, paragraph 2, and paragraph 3. So what they say is, after this pandemic situation, the finance minister have given greater leverage for state governments to get financial resources. That was given in paragraph 1 and paragraph 2. So where they say that state governments can get borrowing to the limit of 5% of gross state domestic product. So directly they can get it from the market. That is the point they are saying. And also other percentages based on their performance. So here you can say that, so both paragraph 1 and paragraph 2, so relates to COVID situation and borrowings. So previously you know that state governments need to entirely depend upon union government for financial resources. Because of this unique situation of COVID, union government is giving the permission for the state governments. Okay, state governments can get 5% of gross state domestic product as borrowing. An extra few percentage, okay, probably around extra percentage based on performance. So based on performance. So and they have given some numbers for it, correct? So for example, 1% will be permitted for borrowing with specific reforms such as debt sustainability, job creation. So all this, if a state government is doing it, they can get extra 0.5% of this gross state domestic product as a borrowing. Another extra 0.5% for another reasons. So altogether around 6% they can get as a borrowing directly from the market. And this, again, you can relate with challenges to federalism, how this pandemic situation has altered the physical relationship between union government and state government. Where here you can see that state government directly approaching the market because of their dire requirement of money. So these are points you can use it in your answer writing. And whereas in paragraph 3 on page 44, so federal relation in India is majorly function of. So federation. So federation is relation between union government and state government. They are saying it's a function of political forces. Function of political forces and structural aspects. So there are two major variables in federal relations in India. One is the political forces. What are political forces means? What is the party in power? Union level and state level, what are the parties in power? That determines the federal relation. And also structural aspects. The example of structural aspect, you can relate to finance commission, or previously we can say about planning commission. Right now we have Niti Aayog. So all this structural aspect also has influence on federal relations. But this author says that mostly the major determinant of federal relation is the political forces. So what type of political forces existing in India have a huge impact on federal relation. And they say that when entire India is dominated by single party, where federation, you can see that it's more towards centralized attitude, where the national party at the Delhi making all major decisions in federal relations. The opposite, when we have coalition politics at the union level, where federation becomes more decentralized and every state governments trying to enforce their or trying to reflect their interest at the federal level. So that's the point what they're saying. So what's the bottom line is, so Indian federation is more a factor of political force rather than structural elements. So though we have a structure for federation, it's more about the political factor. So this can also be a mains question. So paragraph 3 is regarding that news aspect. Next thing is page number 45. So paragraph 1 and paragraph 2. So in paragraph 1 regarding federation, so international conventions and few examples are given. So whenever India signs international conventions, there are subjects which constitutionally belong to the state governments. So there they have given the paragraph saying that how these international conventions are linked with this federal relations. So what the procedure says is, whenever India signs an international conventions on subjects where the state is being involved, so they need to consult with the state governments and they need to make laws which is not against the state government laws. So that's the what paragraph 1 says. Before ratifying the conventions, all this need to be done. Consultative process need to be there. So Indian Federation, so when you take Federation, especially from legislative purpose, it's more based on consultative process. Here this can also be a challenge for federation, because when we are going for global level governance, lot of conventions are being created where it cannot reflect the state aspirations, because it's more about supranational bodies or a larger body, global institutions creating conventions which may match with the national objectives but not with the state objectives. So there may be some challenges in federation regarding this. But what are the process in India is, so before going for ratification, there's a proper consultative process with the state governments. So that is given in there. As in paragraph 2, so this is regarding globalization, paragraph 2, especially what we called as LPG era. So LPG era, where state governments are being allowed to negotiate for loans, FDIs in overseas bank institution directly after 1991. When we introduce our LPG era. So LPG era have a huge impact on Indian federalism, especially fiscal federalism, where state governments, one of the unit of Indian federation, directly interacting with global forces. It can be global institutions or global markets, all you can relate it. So all these are linked here. So here, where union government is considered as a facilitator. So union government is considered as a facilitator in this aspect. That is to attract investments, that is FDIs. So global institutions, correct? So FDI or loans. So global institution loans. So this you can see that how our Indian Federation transformed after LPG era. So this point you can relate. And page number 46 and paragraph 1 and 2. So based on the previous points, so they have given the examples in India. So investment in vibrant Gujarat, where Gujarat government directly went for other countries try to attract investments happening after this LPG era. So they have given the example where Gujarat government created a desk in USA, China, Japan to facilitate investments. Okay, state governments can create a desk is nothing but a facilitation center in those countries to attract investments. This is all possible because of LPG era and the impact on Indian federalism, where the union government is behaving more maturely and giving the space for state governments to attract global investments. For that only they gave the example of so invest in vibrant Gujarat. Investment vibrant Gujarat. So this may be a point. So how this can be a challenges is, as you know, that state governments are given the liberty to attract investments, but actually investment where goes is there are state governments have some natural advantages. What are that natural advantages? Example, the state governments have a coastal areas or have a very good infrastructures, and most of the FDI investment naturally goes there. So this is a challenge right now for Indian federalism, where few states can attract larger investments. So there comes the role of government here. So government how try to balance all those things. So how government is trying to improve the other states. This you can relate with sharing of revenues. So all these are a link here. So even one criticism is UP is getting larger share of union government. The reason is because of this, because it's a disadvantageous position. So central government tried to give a lot of money to union UP so that they can develop their infrastructure, develop their human resources. That creates a level playing field. If that is not being done, naturally that will create a biggest impact on Indian federalism and also in Indian development process, because UP have the largest population, and without proper development that will have a huge impact on entire India. So there's a logic behind this why government is doing it. So if any question regarding regional development, you can use these points, and also why government is doing in that perspective. So that's a challenge because of globalization, when state governments are allowed to approach global players for investments. So certain state governments have natural advantages which can be exploited by the state governments, especially coastal states. And they have given the example of invest in vibrant Gujarat. So this is an interpretation what we are taking, right? Next thing is conclusion, that is paragraph 2. So there are six pillars of federalism: autonomy of states, national integration, centralization, decentralization, nationalization, and regionalization. So all these need to be properly balanced in Indian federalism. The reason is geographical spread, diversity. So all these factors play a role in federalism. So they have given six pillars of federalism. Six pillars of federalism. One is autonomy of states. Autonomy of states. So national integration. National integration, centralization, so decentralization, decentralization, nationalization, and regionalization. And you can see that all the concepts are opposite of each other. For example, if we take centralization, opposite is decentralization, nationalization, regionalization, and autonomy of states and national integration. So all these are opposite concepts. So in Indian Federation, you need to balance all the six parameters to get the best outcome of federalism. So that's a conclusion part. So you'll see a question on this. So the question here, what we are going to discuss is the previous question. So questions crux is, so in Indian Federation we have a strong center, and it goes against the concept of federalism. So that is the crux of the question. So we need to say that why we have a strong federalism. So if you take this question, you need to say what is federalism and why we have strong federalism, what are the reasons behind it. These are historical reasons. We need to list out what are the historical background on which we went for this strong federalism. From this article, you can relate with Jawaharlal Nehru's view, why we need to have a centralized federalism. So you can write that aspects of Nehru, and you can say that why we went for this type of federalism and what are the structural ways of we are achieving it. So if you are able to write the answer for this question in that dimensions, half a part of the answer we can take it from this particular article, and you can say that why we have a strong center. And we can say about in the same article the importance of finance commission. And you know that in finance commission, when the money is being divided between union government and state government, so what you call it as horizontal separation, vertical separation. So all this being done by finance commission, but if you go and see on the total pool, union government get greater share. All this is a tendency of strong federalism or a central federalism. So all this you can quote it, and you say that why that is being required. So that may be the focus of the answer. Okay, thank you.